Welcome to my talk on efficient key recovery attacks for all HFE signature variants. My name is Albrecht Petzoldt, and I'm presenting here a joint work together with Chengdong Tao and Jintai Ding. In our paper, we work over the field of multivariate cryptography, which is one of the main candidates for post-quantum cryptography. And the public key of a multivariate cryptosystem is just a system of multivariate quadratic polynomials as shown here. And the security is based on the so-called MQ problem, where we are supposed to find a vector X bar such that all of these polynomials evaluate to zero. The MQ problem was proven to be NP-hard, and it is believed to be hard on average for both quantum and classical computers. Of course, we have to ensure that the owner of the private key can invert the system efficiently. And one of the ideas to do this is the so-called big field approach, where we have an extension field F q to Cn, an isomorphism phi between the vector space F q to Cn and the extension field. We have an easily invertible univariate map F over the extension field, which is called the central map. And due to the special structure of this central map, the map F bar, which is defined as phi to the minus one circ F circ phi, is a quadratic map over the vector space FQ to the N. To hide the structure of the central map in the public key, we choose two invertible linear maps T and S over the vector space FQ to the N and define the public key as P is T circ F bar circ S, which is a quadratic map over the vector space FQ to the N. It is supposed to look like a random system and therefore hard to invert. The private key consists of the three maps S, F, and T and therefore allows to invert the public key. On this slide, you see a graphical illustration of the general workflow of multivariate big field signature schemes. So for signature generation, we are given a message M as a string of arbitrary length and the private key consisting of the three maps S, F, and T. We first compute the hash value W of the message M. Then we invert the first affine map T to get this X. We lift X to the extension field and invert the univariate central map to get Y in FQ to the N. Finally, we move the result down to the vector space again and invert the second affine map Y to get the signature set in FQ to the N. For signature verification, we are given the message M as a string of arbitrary length, a signature set in FQ to the N, and the public key. And we just have to check if P of Z is equal to H of M. If this is fulfilled, then the signature is accepted, and otherwise it is rejected. An important example for such a big field signature scheme is the HFEV minor signature scheme, which combines the idea of big field signature schemes with a minus modification and the binature variation. The central map F of the scheme is a map from FQ to the V times the extension field FQ to the N to the extension field FQ to the N, and it has this special structure here. So the important thing here is that the degree of this polynomial f of x is bounded by big D. And we have here a linear map beta I in the so-called binature variables V1 to VV. And here we have a quadratic map Y in the binature variables. And due to the special structure of this map F and the Frobenius isomorphism, the map F bar, which is defined as phi to the minus one circ F circ phi, is a quadratic map over the vector space FQ to the N. To hide the structure of the central map in the public key, we choose two linear maps T as a map fq to the n to fq to the n minus a, and s fq to the n plus v to fq to the n plus v of maximal rank. The public key P is given as the composed map T circ F bar circ S, which is a quadratic map from FQ to the N plus V to FQ to the N minus A. And the private key consists of the three maps S, F, and T, and therefore allows to invert the public key. For the signature generation, we are given a message as a string of arbitrary length, as well as a private key S, F, and T. We compute the hash value of the message in FQ to the N minus A. Then we compute a pre-image X of this double vector W in FQ to the N under the affine map T and lift the result to the extension field FQ to the N. Then we choose random values for the integer variables V1 to VV and solve the parameterized map F V of Y is equal to X over the extension field FQ to the N via Burlingame's algorithm. Finally, we move the result down to the vector space again, append the integer variables V1 to VV, and invert the second affine map S to get the signature set of the document in FQ to the N plus V. For the signature verification, we are given again a message M as a string of arbitrary length, the signature set in FQ to the N plus V, and the public key P. We compute first the hash value of the message W in FQ to the N minus A, and we evaluate the public key at the signature points to get this vector W prime in FQ to the N minus A. And we accept the signature set if and only if W prime is equal to W. Against the HFE V minus scheme, there exist basically two attack scenarios. The first one is a so-called direct attack, which is a signature forgery attack. And in a number of papers, it was found out that the degree of regularity of this attack is bounded from above by this formula here, where D is a base 2 logarithm of the degree bound of the HFE polynomial. The second attack scenario is a so-called min rank attack, which is a key recovery attack. And mostly this attack considers the min Q rank, which can be seen as the degree of the public key as a quadratic form over the extension field. And it was found out that the min Q rank of the min rank attack is bounded by D plus A plus V. And therefore, if we solve the min rank problem using the so-called minus approach, the complexity of the attack can be estimated by this formula here. In our paper, we propose a min rank style attack against the HFE V minus scheme, whose complexity is given by this formula here. And we see that A doesn't appear in the complexity at all, and V only appears in the first row. This means that the complexity of our attack is completely independent of the number of minus equations A, and it is polynomial in the number of integer variables V. And therefore, our attack is much faster than previous min rank attacks against HFE variants. To describe our attack, we need some preliminaries. First, we use the so-called matrix representation of the HFE central map. Namely, we can write the HFE central map as a quadratic form using a matrix F star zero, which is given by this formula here. And we can compute from this F star zero the Frobenius maps FQ to the K, similarly as quadratic forms using matrices F star K. And the matrix F star K can be derived easily from the matrix F star 0. Next, we need also a matrix representation of our isomorphism. And we find that the matrix representing the isomorphism is given as a matrix of the van der Waal type, where we use theta as a generator of the extension field F cubed to the n. And by doing so, we find that the isomorphism applied to an element V of the extension field is given as a vector V to VQ to the n minus 1 times m to the minus 1 as a vector of the vector space FQ to the n, and phi to the minus 1 applied on a vector of the vector space FQ to the n is the first component of V1 to Vn times m. In our paper, we have to cover the Binature variables. And to do this, we define a matrix M tilde, which is a block matrix containing the matrix M of our isomorphism and the identity matrix of size V. And by doing so, we get the following equation mapping elements of the vector space to elements of the extension field. Furthermore, if we let S and T be the matrices representing the linear paths of the affine maps F and T, and we let F, we write F again as a quadratic form using a matrix F star 0, then we find that the following relation between the matrices representing the public polynomials and the matrices F star 0 to F star n minus 1. And if we denote in this equation m tilde to the minus 1 times s to the minus 1 by u and m to the minus 1 times t by w, then we find this equation here. And this equation plays a major role in the remainder of the talk, and therefore I denote it by the fundamental equation. So let's see how to recover the first affine map S. So let AI be the first row of the matrix F star I, for I is 0 to n minus 1. And then we can show the following lemma. The rank of the matrix Q is W transpose times the matrix containing the vectors A as row vectors is at most D. W here is a matrix from our fundamental equation. And in particular, we find that this row matrix from A0 to AN minus 1 is a block matrix containing two blocks A1 and A2 and a zero block in the middle. And from the lemma, we directly follow a theorem. If we denote by U the first row of the matrix U from our fundamental equation, and BI is this vector U times the matrix PI representing the I's public polynomial. Then we define a matrix set whose row vectors are these vectors BI, and the rank of set is at most D. And furthermore, we get another lemma. Let A be an M times N matrix over the field FQ, and B be the matrix M to the minus 1 times A, where M is a matrix representing our isomorphism. Then we have Bij is Bi minus 1 J to the Q for all ij. And this means that the matrix B is completely determined by its first row. So let's sum up how to recover F. Since we have U is M tilde to the minus 1 times S to the minus 1 and M tilde is known, it is enough to find U, and we can recover S easily from U. And due to the previous lemma, we only have to find the first row of U to get the first n rows of the matrix U. Then we denote the first row of the matrix U by the vector U. And since we only have to find one of the many equivalent keys, we can assume that the first component of this vector is equal to one. Since the rank of the matrix set is smaller or equal to D, we can find the unknown elements of the vector U by solving a min rank problem over the base field. And the remaining rows of U can be chosen at random such that the matrix U, which is a n plus v times n plus v matrix, is invertible. So here we have the algorithm how to recover S. So we are given the HFE parameters Q and V, D and A, as well as the matrices representing the public polynomials and the matrix M tilde of our isomorphism. And the output is one of the equivalent linear transformations S. So we said Bi is the vector consisting of a one and the elements U1 to UN plus V times n plus v minus 1 times pi, where pi is a matrix representing the i-th public polynomial, and u1 to un plus v minus 1 are unknowns. Then we construct a matrix set whose row vectors are these bi, and solve a min rank problem for this matrix set to find the unknowns u1 to un plus v minus 1. Then we define the matrix U as follows. So the first n rows of this matrix U are given by the vector U or by the solutions of the min rank problem. And the remaining V rows are just chosen randomly in such a way that the whole matrix is invertible. Then we compute S tilde is M tilde to m tilde u to the minus one and return S prime as a equivalent linear transformation. And having found this equivalent linear transformation S, the remainder of the attack is relatively easy. We can show that as soon as the matrix U is known, we can recover the matrix F star zero by solving a determined linear system with n minus a minus one variables, d plus a times n plus v additional linear equations in at most d plus v variables, and two choose from v plus one univariate polynomial equations of degree at most q to the d. And after we have found this matrix F star zero, we can easily compute all the other matrices F star I. And having found these matrices F star I, then we can recover the map T by solving n minus a linear equations in n variables. So let's come to the complexity of our attack. The most costly step of our attack is the solution of the min rank problem. We need to recover the matrix U. For this, there are basically two possibilities. The first one is a Meinhof modeling. We find that the degree of regularity of the F4 algorithm is D plus one, and this leads to the following complexity of our attack. Second possibility is to solve the min rank problem by the support Meinhof modeling. And in comparison to Rainbow, we don't have a unique solution of the min rank problem here, which means that we can't solve the system by the VDM1 algorithm, but we have to solve it by F4. And our experiments seem to show that the degree of regularity of the F4 algorithm is always three, which leads to the following complexity of our attack. However, we don't have a theoretical confirmation that the degree of regularity is 3, and therefore we give the complexity of our attack using the miners modeling. This table here shows how we can apply our attack against the GEMS crypto system, which is a third round candidate in the NIST standardization process of post-quantum signature schemes. And we see here that the proposed parameters for this scheme don't meet the NIST security requirements, especially for higher levels of security. So as I said, the proposed parameters for GEMMS don't reach the required security levels. Furthermore, we find that speeding up the signature generation process of the scheme by decreasing D while increasing A and B is not possible, which means that modifications as done in blue GEMS and red GEMS are not possible. And furthermore, we find that for high levels of security, we need very high levels of the HFE degree bound. For example, for the NIST security level 3, we need small d is greater or equal to 20, or big D is greater or equal to 2 to the 19 plus 1 is 524,000. And this leads to a drastic slowdown of the signature generation process. Therefore, we come to the conclusion that the techniques used in the GEMS scheme don't suffice to create an HFE-based signature scheme, which is both efficient and reaches high levels of security. To conclude, in our paper, we proposed a new mindering style attack against the HFE signature variants, and the complexity of our attack is exponential in D, but polynomial in V, the number of signature variables, and independent of the number of minus equation A. Some consequences. So we see that we can't speed up the scheme by decreasing D while increasing A and V, as it is done in blue GEMS and red GEMS. And for high levels of security, we need a very large value of small d, which brings down the efficiency of the scheme. And therefore, there arises the question if we can build an HFE-based signature scheme, which is both efficient and offers a high level of security. Thank you for your attention.